The Isra wal Mi'raj, when Allah said, Subhanahu alladhi Asra, where was the Prophet taken from? I mentioned. The house of who? Ummu Hani. But what did Allah say? Subhanahu alladhi Asra bi'abdihim, Subhanahu alladhi Asra bi'abdihi laylan min al-masjid al-haram. Ummu Hani's house was on the shi'b of Abi Talib. Allah referred to Ummu Hani's house as what? Which shows that anyone who prays fi hudud Mecca, anywhere in Mecca, you get the reward of praying in the Kaaba. Does that make sense? How much do you get? 100,000, right? The 100,000 is in the entire Mecca, not just the Kaaba.
وأقول قال الله جل جلاله والمصطفى الهادي ولا أتأول.
الحمد لله رب العالمين له الحمد الحسن والثناء الجميل وأشهد أن لا إله إلا الله وحده لا شريك له أراد ما العباد فاعلوه ولو عصمهم لما خالفوه ولو شاء يطيعوه لأطاعوه جميعا وأشهد أن محمداً عبده ورسوله آخر الأنبياء في الدنيا عصراً وأجلهم يوم القيامة شأناً وذكراً صلى الله وملائكته والصالحون من خلقه كما وحد الله وعرف به ودعا إليه أما بعد. In our last session, we spoke about the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم returning back to Mecca from Taif. Here what I want to point out is Ibn Ishaq and Ibn Sa'd, and other than them, there's a mistake they fell into when it came to the Islam of the jinns. Some of the scholars, like Ibn Ishaq, okay, and also Ibn Sa'd, hatta Ibn al-Qayyim, rahimahumullah, may Allah be pleased with all of them, they mentioned that the jinns heard from the Prophet ﷺ after Taif. And that was the first time they embraced Islam when the Prophet returned from Taif. That's the view that Ibn Ishaq, Ibn Sa'd, Ibn al-Qayyim, all of them strengthened. And that is a wahm. It's not the correct opinion. There's a look to that issue. And we already spoke about it already. It actually occurred, them embracing Islam, fibtida'i, the beginning of al-mab'ath, when the messenger was sent out as a prophet, at the beginning it started. And in the beginning it happened. So that's a point I wanted to, inshallah, shed light on. Some of the students asked me last lesson. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he returned from Ta'if and he entered Mecca. That's what we're going to be starting from, inshallah ta'ala, today. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he came to Mecca, and his people hated him, angry, they despised him, alayhi salatu wa sallam. So when the Messenger wanted to enter Mecca, Zayd ibn Haritha, he said, كَيْفَ تَدْخُلُ عَلَيْهِمْ وَهُمْ أَخْرَجُوكَ. How are you going to enter Mecca? And they are the ones who expelled you, exiled you from Mecca. The Prophet then said to Zayd, he said, Ya Zaydu, إِنَّ اللَّهَ جَاعِلٌ لِمَا تَرَى فَرَجًا وَمَخْرَجًا وَإِنَّ اللَّهَ نَاصِرُ دِينِهِ وَمُظْهِرُ نَبِيِّهِ. He said, Zayd, Allah is going to make the opening and He's going to bring the victory. He will, subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this religion, it's Allah's religion. He is the one that's going to aid it and support it. Then the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he reached Al-Hira, the Mount Hira, and he sent a man from the people of Khuza'a. The Messenger sent, when he reached Hira, he sent a man from the tribe of Khuza'a. He sent him, and his name was Abdullah ibn Urayqitin. Abdullah ibn Urayqitin. The Prophet sent him, and he told him to go to Al-Akhnas ibn Shariqin. What was the purpose why the Prophet sent Abdullah ibn Urayqit? Was so that he can speak to Al-Akhnas ibn Shariq to talk to him, to give him shelter and aid. This man is from the people of Khuza'a. The messenger said to Abdullah ibn Urayqit, he said, go to him, speak to Al-Akhnas ibn Shariq and tell him to aid, يعني, give me jiwar. In other words, if one man took you in, the rest will not touch you. So I need this man. When they came to Al-Akhnas, he said, Ana halifu Quraysh. I have an allegiance with Quraysh. I have a tie with Quraysh. Wa rafada ijarata. He refused to give the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam any shelter or help. Then the Messenger told Abdullah ibn Urayqit, he said, go to Suhail ibn Amr. Go to Suhail ibn Amr. Suhail ibn Amr is who? He's the one who's going to have the Sulh al-Hudaybiyah with the Prophet ﷺ, the father of Abu Jandal. So the Prophet ﷺ, he said, go to Abdullah ibn Urayqit, go to Suhail ibn Amr and talk to him and ask him to aid me. When they came to Suhail ibn Amr, he said, Inna bani Amr ibn Rabi'a. Inna bani Amr ibn Lu'ay, sorry. The people of Amr ibn Lu'ay, they are not going to give a shelter and a care to Bani Ka'bin. They're not. And I'm not going to take care of you, Muhammad. And so he refused to aid the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And then the Prophet, third occasion, he said to Abdullah Urayqit, go and speak to Al-Mut'im ibn Adi. Go speak to Al-Mut'im, Mut'im ibn Adi, ibn Adi, so he can aid me and help me. When they came to Mut'im ibn al-Adi, he said, okay, no problem. He asked Abdullah ibn Urayqit, he said, is it Muhammad that wants me? He said, yes. He said, قُلْ لِمُحَمَّدٍ فَلْيَأْتِي. Say to Muhammad, come to me. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he entered Mecca and he stayed with al-Adi, al-Mut'im ibn al-Adi. In the morning, Al-Mut'im ibn Adi, he had six or seven of his sons who were well-trained fighters. He told all six of them, or all seven of them, he said, get ready, wear your armors, equip yourself. He told Muhammad, ayyeh, you are always known in the morning, Fajr, to go to the masjid and pray there. And so come, we know your schedule. We're going to escort you around Mecca. So the children of Al-Mut'im ibn Adi, they took the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam to the Kaaba. And Al-Mut'im ibn Adi said to the Prophet, Tuf! Do Tuf around the Kaaba now. Circumambulate around the Kaaba seven times. And he said to his six or seven sons, all of you have to look after him. No one can touch him. Some of the narrations mention Al-Mut'im ibn Adi, he told four of his sons to stand on the four sides, the corners of the Kaaba. And he told the other two or the other three, based on the number, to be around the Prophet. When he's doing tawaf, do tawaf with him. When he's praying, stand next to him. As the situation was like that, and the Prophet was praying, Aqbala Abu Sufyan. Abu Sufyan came and he saw Al-Mut'im ibn Adi and his sons looking after the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. So Abu Sufyan asked this question. He said, Amujirun am tabi'? Are you guys giving him shelter only, or are you his followers now? Al-Mut'im ibn Adi, are you just helping Muhammad, defending him, protecting him, or are you his followers now and your children? Al-Mut'im ibn Adi said, Bal Mujir. I'm a man who's been sought protection, and I'm doing is protection. Abu Sufyan said, إِذَنْ لَا نُحْفِزُ ذِمَّتَكَ. If that's the case, we are not going to, يعني, we're not going to break, لَا نُحْفِرُ ذِمَّتَكَ. Anyone who you have given shelter to, we're not going to give shelter to. قَدْ أَجَرْنَا مَنْ أَجَرْتَ يَا مُطْعِمْ. Mut'im, anyone who you've given shelter to is being given shelter. Don't worry, no one would harm them. And so the Prophet ﷺ prayed and stayed in the Kaaba, done his tawaf. When the Prophet finished, Al-Mut'im ibn Adi and his children went with the Prophet والسلام, and they went home. Al-Mut'im ibn Adi was a man the Prophet never forgot. Even if it's a non-Muslim and he does you good, the hadith says, مَنْ صَنَعَ إِلَيْكُمْ مَعْرُوفًا فَكَافِئُوهُ. Man is min adawat al-umum. Anyone who does good for you, repay them back. If anyone does something, you try to give them back what they've done. Islam, as a Muslim, if someone does something for you, وَهَلْ جَزَاءُ الْإِحْسَانِ إِلَّا الْإِحْسَانِ. So look what the Prophet said, عليه الصلاة والسلام. The Prophet was known for this. If you did something for the Prophet, he will remember it. As a Muslim, someone did something for you, forget it? كيف? Listen to the story. Al-Mut'im ibn Adi, he died and he passed away as a non-Muslim. And we're later going to see why he refused Islam. There was one specific situation that he made a promise he would never believe in Nabi Muhammad. But his son, Jubayr ibn al-Mut'im, embraced Islam. Was a Sahabiyun Jaleel. He took Islam when he heard the Prophet recite in Salatul Maghrib, أَمْ خُلِقُوا مِنْ غَيْرِ شَيْءٍ أَمْ هُمُ الْخَالِقُونَ. Jubayr ibn al-Mut'im was listening. And when he heard those verses, he said, كَادَ قَلْبِ أَنْ يَطِيرُ. My heart was about to fly out. And he said, that was the first time Islam entered my heart. So even though the father never embraced Islam, and we mentioned this before, Allah brought out of his progeny a person who believes in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the day of judgment. But listen to Al-Mut'im ibn Adi, the position he held. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he took the 70 captives in the Battle of Badr, as you know, the Prophet in the Battle of Badr, the non-Muslims, they lost 70, and 70 were taken as captives. Huh? The Prophet said, لو كان المطعم ابن عدي, if مطعم ابن عدي was alive today, and he spoke to me regarding these 7 captives, 70, he said, ooh, for 70 of them, Muhammad, let them go. I would let them all go without taking anything for it. He said, if المطعم ابن عدي, لو كان المطعم ابن عدي حيا, ثم كلمني في هؤلاء, and he spoke to me regarding these 70 captives, لَتَرَقْتُهُمْ لَهُ, I will let them all go with him. Because of what he did. Hafidh ibn Hajar, look what he said in his Fath al-Bari. He said, أي بغير فداء, needing no money in return. For free, just take them. Then look at Hafidh ibn Hajar mentioned the sabab. He said, من أن المطعم ابن عدي كان من أشد من قام في نقض الصحيفة التي كتبتها قريش. When Quraysh wrote the letter, remember we spoke about it, and the Prophet was boycotted في شعب أبي طالب, and the Prophet stayed there. Who was the one who stood up and ripped the paper? المطعم ابن عدي. So that's one. ومن معه من المسلمين حين حصروهم في الشعب. والسبب الثاني, the second reason was إجارته للنبي صلى الله عليه وسلم. He gave the Prophet protection. عندما أراد دخول مكة عندما رجع من الطائف, when the messenger returned from Taif. الزرقاني, he mentions in شرح المواهب, okay, he says وهذا من شيمته صلى الله عليه وسلم. أما وهذا من شيمه صلى الله عليه وسلم. This was from the Prophet's well-known traits, characteristics, his beautiful characteristics, which is تذكر وقت النصر والظفر للمطعم ابن عدي هذا الجميل. At the time that the Prophet won and Islam beat the people who caused them harm, Quraysh harmed the messenger. This was the first battle Islam and the Muslims felt victory. In this battle, the Prophet remembered a man في وقت في بداية الإسلام, the beginning of Islam, who helped him. He never forgot. Huh? This is one of the signs of the shima and the honor of the Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام. Abu Jahl, as he was always known, he mocked the messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام in this occasion. When he saw the Prophet staying in the house of Al-Mut'im ibn Adi and being taken care of the children of Mut'am ibn Adi, Abu Jahl benefited from this opportunity. He said, كَيْفَ يَحْتَاجُ نَبِيٌّ إِلَى جِوَارٍ. You're a prophet. Why do you need anyone to help you? Why do you need anyone to support you? You're a prophet sent from Allah. Why can't Allah send angels to protect you? You are carrying His message. That's what he said. And then, when the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam, he saw the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam enter the masjid, and Quraysh was sitting there, Abu Jahl got excited and he said to the people of the Prophet, he said, "Hada nabiyyukum ya bani Abd Manaf, bani Abd Manaf. This is your Prophet. Look how he's been taken care of. Look how he's been helped and supported." Utbah ibn Rabi'ah got angry. He's from the people of Abd Manaf. So what did he say? "Wama tunkiru an yakuna minna nabiyyun aw malak?" Are you doubting? Are you rejecting that a prophet can be from us, or an angel, or a king? So he's like he's accepting the prophet's prophecy here, but that's not how it was. Look what the prophet said to him when the prophet heard. He said, "Amma anta ya Utbah." The prophet said, "As for you, Utbah ibn Rabi'ah, for wallahi ma hamayta lillahi wa la li rasulillah. You didn't speak like this for Allah and His Messenger. That's not why you did it. Alakin hamayta li nafsik. You spoke for yourself. You're from the people of Abd Manaf, and I'm from the people of Abd Manaf, and that's why you said what you said. Wa amma anta ya Abu Jahl. As for you, Abu Jahl, for wallahi la yati alayka ghayru kabir min ad-dar hatta tadhhaka qalilan. There's going to come a time when your laughter is going to be very little. You're mocking, huh? Your laughter is going to come to an end. And your cry is going to be a lot and your pain. وَأَمَّا أَنْتُمْ يَا مَعْشَرَ قُرَيْشٍ. As for you, Quraysh, who's sitting there and watching all of this. فَوَاللَّهِ لَا يَأْتِي عَلَيْكُمْ غَيْرَ كَبِيرٍ مِنَ الدَّارِ حَتَّى تَدْخُلُوا فِي مَا تُنْكِرُونَ وَأَنْتُمْ كَارِهُونَ. A lot of you guys are going to enter what you are today disliking. This deen that you guys are laughing and mocking. There's going to come a day where you guys are going to enter it, which today you dislike. A lot of them who were sitting there did embrace Islam, and some of them, their children, embraced Islam. Tonight, my brothers and sisters, we're going to take a long discussion regarding Al-Isra wal Mi'raj. So bear with me, inshallah ta'ala. We're going to take it in different nights, inshallah ta'ala. We'll take some tonight. Next Friday, we're going to take some. We're going to take it in as much details as possible, inshallah ta'ala. This night of Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj, it came tathbeetan li Rasulillahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. It came to solidify the Messenger alayhi salatu wa sallam, to make his heart feel content and happy alayhi salatu wa sallam, for those many years of suffering, pain, and hardship in which he endured alayhi salatu wa sallam, the patience he had to show. Ala adha al-mushrikeen, the harm of the mushrikeen. So let's break this night into the two terms that it has, Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj. The word Al-Isra, as Hafidh ibn Hajar mentioned, he said, Asra ma'khudhatun min as-sara. The word Asra is taken from the term as-sara in the Arabic language. وَهُوَ سَيْرُ اللَّيْلِ is when the person moves nighttime, not daytime. Okay? تقول, the Arabs, they say, أَسْرَى وَسَرَى إِذَا سَارَ لَيْلًا بِمَعْنًا is when the person traverses nighttime. And that's what he said, وَالْمَقْصُودُ بِقَوْلِهِ تَعَالَى, the statement of Allah, where he said, أَسْرَى بِعَبْدِهِ, he said it means, جَعَلَ الْبُرَاقَ يَسْرِ بِهِ. And later we're going to talk about what the buraq is. The buraq is the dabba, the beast that the Messenger mounted on. It took him from Mecca to Bayt al-Maqdis. And all of this happened at night time. It happened from Isha and Fajr. The Prophet was in Mecca. He prayed Salat al-Fajr in Mecca. And that's when him and Abu Jahl had the discussion. All of this happened in one night. And it's a distance that it would take them how long? 1 month to go there, 1 month to go, and 1 month to return if the person didn't spend a lot of time resting too much. All of it happened in what? In one night. Bi'abdihina is Muhammad ittifaqan. There's no dispute that the word bi'abdihi in the verse is referring to who? The Messenger alayhi salatu wassalam. Because the damir is returning back. Wa damiru lillahi ta'ala, the pronoun is returning back to Allah. Bi'abdihi, his slave. Why? Tashrifan. Like when we say Baytullah, the house of Allah, we're honoring this house. Naqatullah, we're honoring the naqa. Bi'abdihi, the slave of Allah. Here is minbabi tashrif. It's to honor the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. And then the scholars, they took from this that you tend to find in the Quran that Allah uses the word abd for the Messenger alayhi salatu wasalam. Fi maqam at-tashrif, a places where he's honoring him. Subhanalladhi asra bi'abdihi, the night Allah ascended his slave. There was many words Allah could have referred to the Prophet with, right? Many titles. There was many descriptions that the Prophet could have, Allah could have given. But he chose to give him what title? Bi'abdihi, his slave. Are we all together, brothers? That's why Allah praised the وَعِبَادُ الرَّحْمَنِ الَّذِينَ يَمْشُونَ عَلَى الْأَرْضِ هَوْنَا. عِبَادُ الرَّحْمَنِ. عِبَادُ الرَّحْمَنِ here is not everybody. Even though everyone is the عِبَادُ الرَّحْمَنِ from the slaves of Allah. أَلَيْسَ كَذَلِكَ? لَكِنْ عِبَادُ الرَّحْمَنِ here is مِنْ بَابِ التَّشْرِيفِ. This one is to honor these people. Are we all together? تكاد السماوات يتفطرن منه وتنشق الأرض وتخر الجبال هدا أن دعوا للرحمن ولدا وما ينبغي للرحمن أن يتخذ ولدا إن كل من في السماوات والأرض إلا آتي الرحمن عبدا. So everyone is a slave. Like in that one, the verse in Surah Maryam is mentioning here is not tashrif. It's عبودية قهر. Are we all together, brothers? Forcefully. Whether you like it or not, you're going to come humiliated, belittled as a slave. Are we all together, brothers? Like in this one, in Surah Isra, is tashrif. Allah uses it even when he's mentioning the sending of the Quran. Alhamdulillah, الذي أنزل على عبده الكتاب. He's talking about sending the Quran on him. Again, he doesn't refer to him except with the word what? When the Prophet stood up to call to the path of Allah and to give da'wah. وَأَنَّهُ لَمَّا قَامَ عَبْدُ اللَّهِ. Allah referred to him again as slave. يعني these maqamat, Allah is choosing that word for a reason. What reason, brothers? Tashrif. So the best thing you can look for, my brothers and sisters, the best thing you can look for is to be the slave of Allah. There is no title greater and better than being a slave to your Lord, Allah. Are we all together, brothers? That's why the poet, he said, وَمِمَّا زَادَنِي فَخْرًا وَتِيهًا وَكِدْتُ بِأَخْمُصِي أَطَأُ الثُّرَيَّ دُخُولِيَ تَحْتَ قَوْلِكَ يَا عِبَادِي وَأَنْ سَيَّرْتَ أَحْمَدَ لِي نَبِيًّا. One of the things that increases me in happiness and joy and raises my aspiration is that you refer to me as my slave at a time I'm committing a sin. قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ أَسْرَفُوا عَلَىٰ أَنفُسِهِمْ. قُلْ يَا عِبَادِيَ الَّذِينَ. My slaves. The poet is saying, look, oh Allah, you're attributing me to yourself at a time I am furthest from you. صح? If you look at the hadith, hadith al-Qudsi, and you underline that part of the hadith where the Prophet said, Allah says, أَعْدَدْتُ لِعِبَادِيَ الصَّالِحِينَ. Ibad, my slaves. I prepared for what? My righteous slaves. No other title. Ibad, slave. أَعْدَدْتُ لِعِبَادِيَ الصَّالِحِينَ. مَا لَا عَيْنُ رَأَتْ وَلَا أُذُنُ سَمِعَتْ ولا خطر على قلب بشر. Who is this place prepared for, which is Jannah? Who is it prepared for? The slaves. Are we all together? So this term, slave, is what we need to all work towards, brothers. If you do not choose to be a slave of Allah, you will forcefully be His slave, because you are. You can never leave His kingdom. But if you don't surrender to Allah as a slave should, and say, Ya Rabbi, you control me, you tell me what to do and you tell me what not to do, what will happen to you is you will lose those privilege that the slaves of Allah receive, subhanahu wa ta'ala. أَعْدَتُ لِعِبَادِيَ الصَّالِحِينَ. I prepared for what? My righteous slaves. Slaves. So that ayah, سُبْحَانَ الَّذِي أَسْرَى بِعَبْدِهِ لَيْلًا مِنَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ إِلَى الْمَسْجِدِ الْأَقْصَى الَّذِي بَارَكْنَا حَوْلَهُ لِنُورِيَهُ مِنْ آيَاتِنَا. بِعَبْدِهِ is tashrif. Allah is honoring the Messenger عليه الصلاة والسلام. When is the time that the Prophet told us that the slave is most closest to Allah? أَقْرَبُ مَا يَكُونُ الْعَبْدُ مِنْ رَبِّهِ وَهُوَ ساجد. So look at this. The Prophet is going up what? He's going up. To who? To Allah. But Allah is reminding him, you're my slave. A slave is below the master, Allah. As Muslims, we believe Nabiullah Muhammad is a slave. But we know he's not an ordinary slave. What slave is he? He's a messenger sent from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why we say he's a Rasul فلا يكذب وعبد فلا يعبد. He's a Rasul فلا يكذب. He's a messenger, so we don't disbelieve in him. But he's also a عبد فلا يعبد. He's a slave, we don't worship him. صح? So Nabiullah Muhammad is not worshipped. That's why when the Sahabas praised him and they said, فينا نبي, there's a prophet amongst us, knows what's going to happen tomorrow, the messenger silenced them and he said, wait. لا تطروني كما أطرت النصارى عيسى بن مريم. Don't go overboard on me. Don't go extreme the way that the Christians went overboard with Isa ibn Maryam. Don't do that to me. ولكن قولوا, but say, عبد الله ورسوله. Say about me, he is the slave of Allah and he is the messenger. Remember this. When he said, I'm a slave, he's put himself below Allah. But when he said a messenger, he has put him higher than the rest of us. And that is the manzila, that's the position that we place him in, alayhi salatu wasalam. We don't go above and below that. We don't treat him like the normal slaves, nor do we treat him like Allah. Are we all together? That's why la ilaha illallah means la ma'buda bihaqqin illallah. The only one whose servitude, ibadah, is done for is who? Who is it done? Only Allah. It's not done for Nabiullah Muhammad. It's not done for لا ملك مقرب ولا نبي مرسل. No prophet, no angel, no one. Only Allah Azza wa Jalla. That's Allah's haq. That cannot be given to who? To anybody else. Are we all together, brothers? If you look at the Quran, Allah mentions 18 prophets. This is ayah is very scary. 18 prophets. الذين آمنوا ولم يلبسوا إيمانهم بظلم أولئك لهم الأمن وهم مهتدون وتلك حجتنا آتيناها إبراهيم على قومه نرفع درجات من نشاء إن ربك حكيم عليم وهبنا له إسحاق ويعقوب كلا هدينا ونوحا هدينا من قبل ومن ذريتي داود وسليمان وأيوب ويونس وموسى وهارون وكذلك نجزي المحسنين وإسماعيل وإدريس و وإسماعيل وإدريس وزكريا ويحيى وإلياس كل من الصالحين. Before that, what did Allah mention? Allah mentioned وسليمان وداود وكلا فضلنا على العالمين ومن آبائهم وذرياتهم وإخوانهم وجتبيناهم وهديناهم إلى صراط مستقيم ذلك هدى الله يهدي به من يشاء ذلك هدى الله يهدي به من يشاء من عباده ولو أشركوا لحبط عنهم ما كانوا يعملون أُولَٰئِكَ الَّذِينَ هَدَى اللَّهِ فَبِهُدَاهُ مُقْتَدِي. After he says it, that's the part I want from it. Here Allah mentions for us 18 prophets. How many prophets? 18 prophets. Those 18 prophets, he says their fathers, their forefathers, their grandchildren, their progeny, all of them. If any one of them diverts ibadah for other than Allah, لَحَبِطَ عَنْهُمْ مَا كَانُوا يَعْمَلُونَ. Allah says, I will nullify all their righteous deeds. All of those prophets. Any one of them who worships other than me, I will destroy all of their actions. And they will suffer severely because of that. This is who? Big prophets. Yeah? This is what? Big prophets. So then what about me and you? So, what about me and you? So here, brothers, that subhana alladhi asra bi'abdihi layla min al-masjid al-haram. Also, it shows you that it was laylan. I have a question now. If I just said to you, subhana alladhi asra, the word asra means what? To go at night time. Then why did Allah mention subhana alladhi asra bi'abdihi laylan? Why did he mention laylan? That's one qawl. That the word laylan here is emphasis. Hayya? It was a part of the night, not all of it. The reason why laylan was emphasized on is because it didn't happen the entire night. It happened a portion of the night. Some scholars, they said, it's because emphasis, as Akhuna Adam mentioned. So we know what al-Isra means. What about al-Mi'raj? What does the word al-Mi'raj mean? Al-Mi'raj is al-Uruj. Al-Uruj is to ascend up. Al-Uruj is what? Is to ascend up, to go up. And the Messenger, alayhi salatu wasalam, that's what happened to him. So al-Isra was, he went from Mecca to what? Baytul Maqdis. And from Bayt al-Maqdis, he went up. That's called Mi'raj. This story is mentioned in two places in the Quran. One is Surah al-Isra. And who knows where the other one is? Put your hand up if you know it. Where else is the story mentioned of al-Isra al-Mi'raj in the Quran? Surah Al-Najm, correct. When Allah tabarak wa ta'ala mentions, وَلَقَدْ رَآهُ نَزْلَةً نَزْلَةً أُخْرَى عِنْدَ سِدْرَةٍ مُنْتَهَى عِنْدَهَا جَنَّةُ الْمَأْوَى إِذْ يَغْشَى السِّدْرَةَ مَا يَغْشَى مَا زَاغَ الْبَصَرُ وَمَا طَغَى لَقَدْ رَآ مِنْ آيَاتِ رَبِّهِ الْكُبَرَى. We're going to touch on those verses later. So Qissat Al-Isra is mentioned, Surah Al-Isra, and the Mi'raj is mentioned in what? Surah Al-Najm. That's where you find Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj. The Isra is mentioned in Surah Al-Isra, and the Mi'raj is mentioned where? In Surah Al-Najm. But the Sunnah mentioned the Isra and the Mi'raj together. In order to know both of them in details, you have to go to the Sunnah. Another point I want to mention is that the Isra wal-Mi'raj is mass transmission, is mutawatir. It's not some Sahabas narrated it or it's mutawatir. Al-Khattab, Al-Hafiz Abu Al-Khattab, Umar ibn Dihya, he mentions in his kitab, Al-Tanwir fi Mawlid al-Siraj al-Munir, Hafiz ibn Kathir transmitted it from him. He said, وَقَدْ تَوَاتَرَتِ الرِّوَايَاتُ فِي حَدِيثِ الْإِسْرَاءِ عَنْ عُمَرَ بْنِ الْخَطَّابِ وَعَلِيِّ بْنِ أَبِي طَالِبٍ وَابْنِ مَسْعُودٍ وَأَبِي ذَرٍّ وَمَالِكٍ بْنِ صَعْصَعَةٍ وَأَبِي هُرَيْرَةَ وَأَبِي سَعِيدٍ وَابْنِ عَبَّاسٍ وَشَدَّادٍ بْنِ أَوْسٍ وَأُبَيِّ بْنِ كَعْبٍ وَعَبْدِ الرَّحْمَنِ بْنِ قُرَظٍ وأبي حبة وأبي ليلة الأنصاريين وعبد الله بن عمرو بن العاص وجابر وحذيفة وبريدة وأبو أيوب وأبو أمامة وسمرة بن جندب وأبي الحمراء وشهيب الرومي وأم هاني وعائشة وأسماء بنتي أبي بكر الصديق رضي الله عنهم جميعا. All of those companions narrated it. But there's differences in their narrations. Some went in detail, some of them mentioned some things, some omitted others. There's differences. So it's all authentic. Those narrations, some of them have been narrated, of course, weak, but majority of them, inshallah ta'ala, are authentic. So it's a mass transmission. The Muslims are in unanimous agreement when it comes to Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj. The people who reject it are the zanadiqa, the heretics, those who يريدون ليطفئوا نور الله بأفواههم والله متم نوره ولو كره الكافرون. They want to extinguish the light of Allah تبارك وتعالى with their mouths. And Allah inshallah ta'ala is going to allow the light to grow even if the disbelievers hate it. When did Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj happen? The scholars disputed one another regarding wuqu' al-Isra wal-Mi'raj. When did the Isra wal-Mi'raj happen? Some of the scholars, they said, it happened before the Hijrah, 1 year before the Hijrah. This is the view of Ibn Sa'din. He mentions this in his Tabaqat. He says, كان الإسراء والمعراج. The Isra wal-Mi'raj, it was ليلة السابع عشر من شهر ربيع الأول قبل الهجرة بسنة. 1 year before the Hijrah. That's his view and others. And it's also the view Al-Imam al-Nawwi, rahimahullah, he pushed. Al-Imam al-Nawwi. And Abu Muhammad ibn Hazm, he transmitted ijma' on the view of Ibn Sa'd here. But it's not true. There's no ijma' on it. Okay? There is a khilaf on the issue. Some of the scholars, they transmitted the view that it was in Rajab. And this is the view Ibn Abdul Barr. And also Nawawi mentioned this view as well in his Rawdah. But he also mentioned another view in his Majmu', the Sharah of Muhaddab Abi Ishaq al-Shirazi, that it was 3 years before the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam's Hijrah. And this is the view of, no, 2 years before the Hijrah. And this is the view of Ibn Athir, 2 years before the Hijrah, sorry. That which seems apparent, wallahu a'la wa a'lam, is that there is no strong 100% opinion here. There is no 100% opinion on the year, the month. There is no strong opinion on that. What year was it? What month was it? Even what day it was. There is not 100% on this issue. Okay? But what is agreed is that it happened, number one. It is also agreed that it happened after Ta'if. Ijma'. There's no khilaf. It was after Ta'if. That's agreed upon. Isra wal-Mi'raj, was it the Prophet's body and his ruh, or was it just his ruh and his body was still there in Makkah? Hey, who believes his body was there and it was just his ruh? Put your hand up. Yeah? Who thinks his body was there in Makkah and it was his ruh that was taken? Put your hand up. Who believes that the Prophet was physically taken, alayhi salatu wasalam, from Makkah to and who believes the first opinion, that was his body was there and it was just his ruh that was taken? No one. So everyone here believes that his body was taken as well with his ruh. Put your hand up if you believe his body and his ruh, both of them were taken. So the ones who don't put their hand up, I'm guessing you're in the next, because those are the two options you have. I'm confused. The first opinion, no one puts their hands up. When I ask the second opinion, some people put their hand up and some don't. So the ones who haven't put their hands up, are you on the first opinion? Yeah? So I'll ask again. You have to choose one of the two opinions. Who believes that the Prophet's body was not taken, only his soul was taken? Put your hand up. So anyone who has it, no one's put their hand up, sah? That means all of you guys, you're all to the next second view, which is that his body and his soul was all taken. Sah? Okay. So there are some scholars who said that his body wasn't taken and only his soul was taken. Okay? That's a very weak opinion. A very weak opinion. The strongest opinion is that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam, his body and his soul was taken. Hey, what's your evidences that both was taken? All of you guys said his body and his soul was taken, right? So I have the rights to ask anyone. Hey, all of you guys, what's your evidence that his body and his soul were both taken? Hey, Habibi. Huh? أما الدليل أن الروح هو جسد كله مخذ. ما يحتاج إلى براق؟ ما يكون منام مثلا في المنام؟ لا كله البراق كله في المنام. أيه؟ خيه ها؟ بعبدي لكن ما يمنع هذا أن تكون في المنام. نريد دليل حازم قاطع أن جسده صلى الله عليه وسلم أسري ليلة ها؟ وابري because he stored a lot of things. He saw a lot of things in his dream. What's the problem? I need دليل. He saw Allah. But is it seeing it with his eyes or seeing it in his dream? Yeah, Ibrahim. لقد رآه. Okay. But like there's رؤية منامية. When I wake up sometimes from my dreams, I saw a lot of things. صح? If you see the Prophet in your dream, did you see the Prophet? The Prophet said, مَنْ رَآنِي فِي الْمَنَامِ فَقَدْ رَآنِي فَإِنَّ الشَّيْطَانَ لَا يَتَمَثَّلُ بِي. So there's رؤية البصر and there's رؤية المنامية. And what's the دليل that the Prophet's body was taken? عليه الصلاة والسلام. هيا. He could have led the prayer in the dream. ها فضل. ها؟ Lakin, the brother he said, we have to go according to the asr. وَلَقَدْ رَآهُ The asr is رُؤْيَةُ الْبَصَرِ. But then, some of the mufassirin would say, لَقَدْ رَآهُ أي he رَأَى رَبَّهُ He saw his Lord that night. Huh? قَدْ يَكُونُ فِي الْمَنَامِ مَا يَمْنَعُ مُو هَذِ الدِّلِي هَيَ He was, but why can't the beast be in the dream? The Buraq took him in the dream, and the Prophet went. What's the problem? Hayya. Ah. Ah. If you were close, then you went off. You were close, then you went off. هيا ما الدليل فيها؟ هيا Because the other team, they're arguing that the Prophet was in his bed. Alayhi salatu wasalam. Hey, Muhammad. Huh? So then what's the outcome of that? He told him that he went there. هيا فضل. His heart was opened. صلى الله عليه وسلم صح. So what's that got to do with Isra and Miraj? That's the first دليل. The fact that the Prophet's chest was open, that was a physical thing that was done to him, which means this was a journey of his physical side. You kind of mentioned it, but you didn't touch on it. When the Prophet said, I went that night, they said, we cut the distance of 1 month and you're telling us all of this happened in one night? And then Abu Jahl said, wait. I'm going to call Quraysh. Can you tell them what you just told me? If it was a dream, it wouldn't be shocking to Abu Jahl. He'd be like, okay, a dream, I have dreams as well. What happened after the ending of the story clarifies it was a physical thing that happened to the Prophet. If it was just a dream, as we're going to see, some people left Islam. Some people left Islam because of Isra al-Mi'raj. They apostated. And even Al-Mut'im ibn Adi, this is where he said, I'm never going to believe you, ever. I'm never going to follow Islam. I already had my doubts about you, but this one's clear now. Are we all together? An exception, we're going to see, بإذن الله الكريم. Look at what Ibn Jarir al-Tabari said. Ibn Jarir said, وَالصَّوَابُ مِنَ الْقَوْلِ فِي ذَلِكَ عِنْدَنَا أَن يُقَالَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ أَسْرَى بِعَبْدِهِ مُحَمَّدٍ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ مِنَ الْمَسْجِدِ الْحَرَامِ إِلَى الْمَسْجِدِ الْأَقْصَى كَمَا أَخْبَرَ اللَّهُ عِبَادَهُ وَكَمَا تَظَاهَرَتْ بِهِ الْأَخْبَارُ عَنْ رَسُولِ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ وَأَنَّ اللَّهَ تَعَالَى حَمَلَهُ عَلَى الْبُرَاقِ حَيْثُ أَتَاهُ بِهِ وَصَلَّى هُنَالِكَ بِمَنْ صَلَّى مِنَ الْأَنْبِيَاءِ وَالرُّسُلِ فأراه ما أراه من الآيات ولا معنى لقول من قال أسرى بروحه دون جسده. Here, Ibn Jarir is going to refute those who said his body was not involved, it was only his soul. He said, لأن ذلك لو كان كذلك لم يكن في ذلك ما يوجب أن يكون ذلك دليلا على نبوته. If it was a dream, there's no evidence in his prophecy in this. The dalil of his prophecy is that he did a journey that no one can ever do in one night. Impossible. And the things that he saw all in that one night, it's impossible for anybody to see. This is what separates him from the rest of the people. That's what he says. وَلَا حُجَّةَ لَهُ عَلَى رِسَالَتِهِ وَلَا كَانَ الَّذِينَ أَنْكَرُوا حَقِيقَةَ ذَلِكَ مِنْ أَهْلِ الشِّرْكِ. Again, why did they reject it? If it was a dream, they would have been like, I have dreams as well. They rejected because he said, I physically went there, alayhi salatu wasalam. Hafidh ibn Kathir also mentioned it. He says, al-aktharuna min al-ulama ala annahu usriya bi badanihi wa ruhihi yaqadatan la manaman. In other words, the messenger was awake. He wasn't sleeping. As we're going to see later, he did say at the beginning, when the angel came to me and he took me, I was bayna al-manami wal-yaqadha. I was between it. Until he brought me to Mecca, then I woke up. I realized everything around me. Sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Ibn Kathir mentions that, rahimahullah, even the ayah, وَمَا جَعَلْنَا الرُّؤْيَا الَّتِي أَرَيْنَاكَ إِلَّا فِتْنَةً لِلنَّاسِ وَالشَّجَرَةَ الْمَلْعُونَةَ فِي الْقُرْآنِ in Surah Al-Isra. Ibn Abbas, he said in the tafsir of this ayah, هِيَ رُؤْيَا عَيْنٍ أُلِيهَا رَسُولُ اللَّهِ صَلَّى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ لَيْلَةَ أُسْرِيَ بِهِ وَالشَّجَرَةَ الْمَلْعُونَةَ شَجَرَةُ الزَّقُّومِ. Also the ayah, مَا زَاغَ الْبَصَرُ وَمَا طَغَى. The basar here is al-basaru min al-alati al-dhati lal-ruh. If you say ru'ya is something different, it can be used like in basar is the eye. There's no other interpretation for that. So then Ibn Kathir said the basar is the eyes. And the ayah mentions مَا زَاغَ الْبَصَرُ وَمَا طَغَى in Surah Al-Najm, which is referring to the Prophet's eyes. Okay, it didn't deviate. It did see what it saw. Hafiz ibn Hajar also mentions in Fath al-Bari, rahimahullah, he said, وَقَدْ اِخْتَلَفَ السَّلَفُ بِحَسْبِ اِخْتِلَافِ الْأَقْبَارِ الْوَارِدَةِ فَمِنْهُمْ مَنْ ذَهَبَ إِلَىٰ أَنَّ الْإِسْرَاءُ الْمِعْرَاجَ وَقَعَ فِي لَيْلَةٍ وَاحِدَةٍ فِي الْيَقَظَةِ بِجَسَدِ النَّبِيِّ وَرُوحِهِ بَعْدَ الْمَبْعَثِ وَإِلَىٰ هَذَا ذهب الجمهور من العلماء المحدثين والفقهاء والمتكلمين وتواردت عليه ظواهر الأخبار الصحيحة ولا ينبغي العدول عن ذلك إذ ليس في العقل ما يحيله حتى يحتاج إلى تأويل. Again, there's no need to doubt this. This is a mu'jiza, a miracle. Again, another point I want to mention before I go into the story, Al-Isra wal-Mi'raj happened in one time of the Prophet's life, alayhi salatu wasalam. Okay? Just because the narrations look different and they look like they mentioned different points, they all happened what? كَانَ مَرَّةً وَاحِدَةً. It was one time. It wasn't multiple times. Okay? It was what? Multiple times. It wasn't multiple times. It was once that it happened. Ibn al-Qayyim, he said, وَالصَّوَابُ الَّذِي عَلَيْهِ أَئِمَّةُ النَّقْلِ أَنَّ الْإِسْرَاءَ كَانَ مَرَّةً وَاحِدَةً بِمَكَّةَ بَعْدَ الْبِعْثَةِ. He mentions this in his Zad, the third volume, page 38. It only happened once. Let's go into the story, inshallah. Bukhari and Muslim both narrated, and other than them, from the A'immatul Hadith wa ulama'i siyar, they mention this event in details. Inshallah ta'ala, all of the narrations, we're going to go through it now. Anas ibn Malik, and he said, Inna Malik ibn Sa'sa'a. Malik ibn Sa'sa'a has a narration on this. He said, Anna Nabiya Allahi sallallahu alayhi wa sallam haddathahum al laylata usriya bihi. The messenger told them the story of the night of al-Isra wal Mi'raj. The Prophet said the following, salawatullahi wa sallam alayhi. The Prophet, he said, Bainama ana fil hatimi. I was in Hatim. Hatim, and some of the narrations mentioned, Bainama ana fil hijri. I was in the hijr. Okay? Hafidh ibn Hajar mentioned, this shak comes from the narrator Qatadat ibn Da'amat al-Sadusi. Qatadat did the confusion here. Okay? This confusion, it came from him. Bainama ana na'imun fil hatim. And a place he said Hijr. And the Hijr and the Hatim are both the same thing. It's ma bayna al-rukn wal-maqam. It's between what? The rukun and the maqam. Ama bayna al-zamzam wal-hijr. Hijr Ismail. And ma al-zamzam in between there. Okay? That's what it is. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, baynama ana fil hatim wa rubbama qala fil hijri mudbaji'an. Some of the narrations mentioned, بَيْنَ النَّائِمِ وَالْيَقَضَى. The Prophet was slightly sleeping. The Prophet was in whose house? It was in the house of Ummu Hani. Okay, it was in the house of Ummu Hani. And the Messenger was sleeping and the roof was opened of where he was staying. The roof was lifted and he came out. عليه الصلاة والسلام, he's taken out. إِذْ أَتَانِ آتٍ أَيْ كَيْمَ came to me فَقَدَّ is... يعني when you cut something طولا is he opened my chest this way, not this way. فقد, it means القطع طولا is when you cut it like this from top to bottom. He opened the Prophet's chest. He opened it. The Prophet, he was sleeping between two men. Who knows who he was sleeping between? The night of Isra al-Mi'raj. Okay? No. Abu Talib passed away. Abu Talib is dead now. He was sleeping, the Prophet was sleeping between two people when the angels came and they started to talk to each other. They said, which one is it? And then one of the angels said, the one in the middle. Hey, who was he sleeping between? The Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam. He was sleeping between Ja'far and Hamza. The Prophet was sleeping between Ja'far and Hamza. The angel came and he took him, which was Jibreel, and he opened the Prophet's chest, alayhi salatu wasalam. When he took the Prophet's chest, he placed it inside a tastim min dhahabin. He placed it in a tast is a utensil. He put him with ma'i zamzam, cleaned it with zamzam water, and the utensil was made out of gold. Why? Why specifically gold? I wrote 12 pages on the benefits of gold. I'm not going to share it with you guys and why you should invest in gold instead of Bitcoin. But I'll just mention one benefit. Hafiz ibn Hajar mentions, he says, خُصَّ الذَّهَبُ لِكَوْنِ أَغْلَى أَنْوَاعِ الْأَوَانِي. The reason why the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, the utensil in which his heart and his qalb was put in was gold, is gold is the best. Gold is the best. Because brothers, gold has intrinsic value. Its value is not connected to the value that humans give it. It's already got value. Bitcoin's value is where? You and I make value for it. By the way, I'm not saying it's haram. But I'm just saying, does it have intrinsic value? Does Bitcoin have intrinsic value? Huh? Or a famous Twitter user will just tweet and Bitcoin might go up or might go down. Or the cryptocurrency might go up or might go down just because of his tweets. But gold has intrinsic value, meaning its value is in it, regardless of whether people sell it for big price or not. Why? Gold doesn't wear out. Fire cannot destroy gold. It will melt it. Gold will never go by burning it. It's a very strong rock. So the reason why it was chosen is, first of all, it's the best utensil. And it's clean. Gold can be cleaned. It's a very strong. The other thing is, gold is one of the heaviest. It's afqalul jawahir. And the wahyi is heavy. The revelation is heavy. So Ibn Hajar said, fatanasab. So inshallah ta'ala. Also, gold has beauty. So beautiful, right? Gold is beautiful. Are we all together, brothers? There's a mas'ala I was researching about people who eat gold now. Have you seen it? Gold in chocolate and stuff like that. Have you guys seen that? Huh? Allahumma barik. Thumma utitu, I was brought, the Prophet said, bitastin min dahabin. The utensil was made out of gold. Mamlu'atin imanan. It was filled with iman and wisdom. The Messenger of Allah was a person whose iman was high and it was full of wisdom, alayhi salatu wasalam. Then the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasalam, and this is where the Isra al-Mi'raj starts. The Isra al-Mi'raj, when Allah said, subhanallah, Asra, where was the Prophet taken from? I mentioned. The house of who? Ummu Hani. But what did Allah say? Subhanalladhi asra bi'abdihi laylan min al-masjid al-haram. Ummu Hani's house was on the shi'b of Abi Talib. Allah referred to Ummu Hani's house as what? Which shows that anyone who prays fi hududi Makkah, anywhere in Makkah, you get the reward of praying in the Kaaba. Does that make sense? How much do you get? 100,000, right? The 100,000 is in the entire Makkah, not just the Kaaba. Anywhere in Makkah, in your hotel, you get the reward. Because of the ayah, subhanalladhi asra bi'abdi laylan min al-masjid al-haram. The Prophet wasn't taken initially from the Masjid al-Haram. Where was he taken from? The house of Ummu Hani, which was in Makkah. Are we all together, brothers? Does that make sense? This is the dalil that the ulama use. Hamd al-Amin al-Shanqiti has a good research on it in his Adwa' al-Bayan fi Idah al-Quran bil-Quran. Look at it, inshallah ta'ala. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, Jibreel said to the Prophet, come. The Prophet was then told to go on a buraq. The buraq that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he was told to go on, he said, it's bigger than a donkey and it's smaller than a horse, even smaller than a mule. What's a mule? The child of the donkey and the horse. It's even a bit smaller than that, but it's bigger than the donkey. When the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam wanted to climb the buraq ran. Then Jibreel said to him, buraq, what's your issue? No one has ever mounted on you better than Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. No one's ever been on you better than the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Keeping in mind, before that, did the buraq, any other prophet go on it? Yes. Ibrahim, when he came to bring Hajara and his son Ismail to Mecca, he was on the buraq, the scholars mentioned. And when he returned with the buraq, the scholars mentioned. And as we're going to see later, when the Messenger comes to Baytul Maqdis, and Jibreel says to him, tie the buraq on this rock. This is the rock that the prophets used to tie the buraq. So this was a beast that used to be mounted on by prophets before. And who is the best of them? Nabiullah Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The narration mentioned that Buraq already had its saddle on and it also had a rope. It was ready straight away. It refused the Prophet ﷺ, and then the angel Jibreel said to him, أَبِي مُحَمَّدٍ تَفْعَلُ هَذَا. Are you doing this to the Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam? فَمَا رَكِيبَكَ أَحَدٌ أَكْرَمَ عَلَى اللَّهِ مِنْهُ. No one greater and better has ever mounted on you than the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. What did he do? The Buraq started to shiver. And it started to sweat. عَرَقًا. The narration says, فَرْفَضَّ عَرَقًا. It started to sweat a lot. And then it placed its legs deep. And then it waited for the Prophet to come. The Prophet went on it, sallallahu alayhi salatu wasalam. The Prophet then went speed on the Buraq. The Prophet said, I tied it. فَرَبَطْتُهُ بِالْحَلْقَةِ الَّتِي يَرْبِطُهَا الْأَنْبِيَاءِ. When I went to Bayt al-Maqdis, I tied it where the Prophets used to tie it. So it means that the Buraq used to be used before. ثُمَّ دَخَلْتُ الْمَسْجِدِ. I entered the masjid. فَصَلَّيْتُ فِي رَكْعَتَيْنَ. I prayed 2 rak'ah. ثُمَّ خَرَجْتُ. And then I left. There is a dispute amongst the scholars. Did the Prophet see these things when he went to Bayt al-Maqdis, or was it when he returned from Bayt al-Maqdis? Inshallah ta'ala, either way, we will mention some of the things that the Prophet saw when he was going to Bayt al-Maqdis, things that he was shown. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, inshallah ta'ala, the view that we're strengthening is that he saw these things when he was going to Bayt al-Maqdis. The first thing he saw, as Al-Imam Malik narrated in his Muwatta, من حديث يحيى بن سعيد الأنصاري, he said أنه أسري برسول الله فرأى عفريتا. The messenger saw the big jinns. The jinns, they have levels. The Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم, he saw عفريت, the big ones. Okay. And they were asking the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم بشعلة من النار. They were saying, give us fire. We need fire. They were begging the Prophet for fire. Every time the Prophet looks at them, they ask him. Every time he looks, they ask him. Jibreel then said to the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, أَفَلَا أُعَلِّمُكَ كَلِمَاتٍ. Shall I not teach you some words? تَقُولُهُنَّ, which you can say. إِذَا قُلْتَهُنَّ, if you say those words, those jinns that are asking you for those fire, they will disappear and they will go. The Prophet said, بَلَا, of course, tell me. Imagine seeing the world of the jinn, how scary that is. إِنَّهُ يَرَاكُمْ هُوَ وَقَبِيلُ مِنْ حَيْثُ لَا تَرَوْنَهُمْ. They can see us, but being open to see them. So the Prophet said, of course. Then Jibreel said to him, say, أَعُوذُ بِوَجْهِ اللَّهِ الْكَرِيمِ وَبِكَلِمَاتِ اللَّهِ تَامَّاتِ الَّتِي لَا يُجَاوِزُهُنَّ بَرٌّ وَلَا فَاجِرٌ مِنْ شَرِّ مَا يَنْزِلُ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ وَشَرِّ مَا يَعْرُجُ فِيهَا وَشَرِّ مَا ذَرَأَ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَشَرِّ مَا يَخْرُجُ مِنْهَا وَمِنْ فِتَنِ اللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ وَمِنْ طَوَارِقِ اللَّيْلِ وَالنَّهَارِ إِلَّا طَارِقًا يَطْرُقُ بِخَيْرٍ يَا رَحْمَنُ. Al-Imam Malik narrated this in his Muwatta. He narrated it mursalan. Al-Imam Ahmad narrated it mawsulan in his Musnad. Al-Sheikh Muhammad Nasiruddin Al-Albani rahimahullah in Silsila Ahadith Al-Sahiha authenticated it. This narration. So that's the first thing that the Prophet saw. The second thing that the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he saw, and Imam Ahmad narrated this in his Musnad, bi sanadin sahih, it's authentic, that Ibn Abbas, he said, قَالَ أُسْرِيَ بِالنَّبِيِّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمَ إِلَى الْبَيْتِ الْمَقْدِسِ ثُمَّ جَاءَ مِنْ لَيْلَتِهِ فَحَدَّثَهُمْ بِمَسِيرِهِ. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he saw Dajjal عليه الصلاة والسلام. In what? In another human form? لا. في صورته, in the form that Dajjal is going to come in. رؤيا عين. It wasn't a dream. He saw with his eyes. Everything that's happening is with his eyes. He literally saw him عليه الصلاة والسلام. Then the messenger was asked about Dajjal. How was he when you saw him? The Prophet عليه الصلاة والسلام, he said, رأيته فيلمانيا. I saw him, the Prophet صلى الله عليه وسلم. الفيلماني, it is a person who's big. عظيم الخلقة, he's very big. Also, his description, the Prophet said, is أَقْمَرَ شَدِيدَ الْبَيَابِ, very white. إِحْدَى عَيْنَيْهِ قَائِمَةً, one of his eyes is in its place, the other one not. كَأَنَّهَا كَوْكَبٌ دُرِّي, and his hair, it's, he said it was like straight, like a tree in its, where its leaves were dropping, the Prophet said عليه الصلاة والسلام. The third thing that the Prophet saw عليه الصلاة والسلام is what Imam al-Bayhaqi narrated in his Dala'il min hadith Anas ibn Malik. The Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam, he saw بعجوز على جانب الطريق, عجوز, elderly person on the side of the road. In another riwayah it says بمرأة, a woman حاسرة عن ذراعيها, her arms were like this, she put her garments behind her arms, so I could see her forearms. وعليها من كل زينة خلقها الله, and all the beauty, she's an old woman, so when you look at her you can see an old woman, but all the beauty on this earth is on her, gold, diamonds, jewels, all of it is on her. Then she spoke to the Prophet, she said, Ya Muhammad, Muhammad, أنظرني أسألك, can you stop so I can talk to you? The Prophet's on the Buraq, he's moving. So she's saying, please stop, I want to talk to you, I want to ask you something. The Prophet said, فَلَمْ أَلْتَفِتْ إِلَيْهَا, I tried not to look at her. And I never stood, and I never stopped for her. Then he said, Jibreel, what is this? مَا هَذِهِ يَا جِبْرِيلُ, Jibreel, what is it that I can see? I pay attention to this, brothers. He said, سِرْ يَا مُحَمَّدْ, keep moving, Jibreel. فَسَارَ مَا شَاءَ مَا سَارَ, the Prophet went as long as he wanted to go. Then the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as they were going, فَإِذَا شَيْءٌ يَدْعُوهُ مُتَنَحِيًا عَنِ الطَّرِيقِ, again, the Prophet is trying to not look, someone is calling them on the side of the road. Jibreel is saying, هَلُومَ يَا مُحَمَّدْ, Muhammad, keep moving, don't stop for anyone. سِرْ يَا مُحَمَّدْ, and he kept moving, and he kept moving, alayhi salatu wasalam. The narration says, until they reached Bayt al-Maqdis, and then the Prophet asked, he said, Jibreel, what was that I saw? He said, أَمَّا الْعَجُوزِ الَّذِي رَأَيْتَ عَلَى جَانِبِ الطَّرِيقِ, that elderly woman that you saw on the side of the road, that's what remains from this dunya. فَلَمْ يَبْقَ مِنَ الدُّنْيَا إِلَّا مَا بَقِيَ مِنْ عُمْرِ تِلْكَ الْعَجُوزِ, all that remains from the dunya is whatever remains from that woman's age. وَأَمَّا الَّذِي أَرَادَ أَن تَمِيلَ إِلَيْهِ, and as for the person who was on the side of the road that was calling you and that you were trying to run away from, then this is the enemy Iblis that you saw. That was Iblis himself. He wanted you to come and stop for him for a little bit so he can talk to you. As for the fourth thing that the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam saw, was the Messenger sallallahu alaihi wasallam was going and he smelled a beautiful smell that took him. It was a rih tayyib, beautiful smell, sallallahu alaihi wasallam. And Imam Ahmad narrated this in his Musnad and Ibn Hibban in his Sahih bi sanadin hasan, inshallah ta'ala. Ibn Abbas mentioned it. The ra'iha was tayyiba. Then the Prophet said, Ya Jibreel, ما هذه الرائحة الطيبة, what is this beautiful smell? They, Jibreel said to him, هذه رائحة ماشطة بنت فرعون وأولادها, this is the smell of the woman who used to comb the hair of the daughters of فرعون. This is the woman who used to comb the hair of the daughters of Fir'aun. She used to comb their hair. Or the children that Fir'aun was taking care of. Are we all together? So then he said, وَمَا شَأْنُهَا, what's her story? One day she was combing the hair of the daughter of Fir'aun, this woman. And إِذْ سَقَطَتِ الْمِدْرَى, the comb fell out of her hand. Then she said, Bismillah, when it fell. When she said, Bismillah, the daughters of Fir'aun, the daughter of Fir'aun said to her, Bismillah, Abi. When you say Bismillah, Allah, do you mean my father? Because her father was worshipped, right? She said, La. Walakin Rabbi wa Rabba Abika. My father, so my Lord and the Lord of your father. Wa Rabbuka Abika, Allah. The girl said, أخبره بذلك. I'm going to snitch. I'm going to tell my father that you said this to me. قالت نعم. She said, okay. Yes, go ahead. فأخبرته. She went and she told her father, Fir'aun. فدعاها. He called this woman. He said, come. She came. He said, هيا يا فلانة. هيا, what's your story? وَإِنَّ لَكَ رَبًّا غَيْرِي. You have a Lord other than me. قالت نعم ربي وربك الله. My Lord and your Lord. Then he said, get a pot ready. Okay. Fill it with يعني, hot oil. Burn it. So it burns excessively. And put her and her children in there. Her children one by one were put in there just so she can come back. She refused. When they get put in, it's so hot that their skin and their bones separate straight away from each other. Then she became a bit scared when she had the last child with her. She got a bit worried and concerned. The child that she was breastfeeding, that she had, said to her, فَإِنَّ عَذَابَ الدُّنْيَا أَهْوَنُ مِنْ عَذَابِ الْآخِرَةِ. The adab of this pot is nothing compared to the adab of the hereafter. So she said, jump in there, mom. Abdullah ibn Abbas, he said, تَكَلَّمَ أَرْبَعَةٌ وَهُمْ صِغَارٌ. There were four who spoke when they were young. In their, as babies, they spoke. Four. Ibn مَا شَطَّتْ بِنْتَ فِرْعَوْنٍ. The woman who used to comb the hair of the daughters of Fir'aun. That was the woman we just mentioned. وَشَاهِدُ يُوسُفَ. You know, like Yusuf, remember when the woman wanted to commit zina with Yusuf. Who was the one who judged between them? And mentioned that if the khamis is ripped from the front, then she wanted to do something. And if it's ripped from the back, who mentioned this? It was a kid. Also sahibu Juraij, qisatu Juraij. And last but not least, Isa ibn Maryam. But this is not only the four. There's more than four. Who can add more? Ayah? Akhs, Ashab al-Ukhdud. Who can add one more? That spoke. Who can add another baby that spoke? The hadith of the mother that was breastfeeding her child and she walked by a king. And she said, everybody was running after the king and the king was big and everything. And the mother said, I wish my son one day is like this. And the kid took the breast milk out of his, and he looked at his mom and said, A'udhu billah, I don't want to be like this man. And then after that, she walked and she saw a slave girl that was being imprisoned and she was being accused of zina. And she said, I wish my daughter never, my child never becomes like this. And then he spoke and he said to her, Wallahi ma sariqat wala zanat. Wallahi, she did not steal. And wallahi, she did not commit zina. She's a righteous woman. A hadith al-Imam al-Bukhari narrated in his Sahih. So there's more than four that spoke. But that was also one of the things that the Prophet alayhi salatu wasalam saw. We'll stop there inshaAllah ta'ala. سبحانك اللهم وبحمدك أشهد أن لا إله إلا أنت أستغفرك وأتوب إليك